यू डॉक्टर भल्ला।
यस शलभ, यू कैन स्टार्ट. भला, यू कैन स्टॉप शेयरिंग.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर प्रताप विश्वास फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी।
यस शलभ, वी कैन सी, यू कैन कैरी ऑन.
Am I audible to everyone?
Yeah,
Yeah.
please
Yes.
carry on.
So the problems with cataract, as I see it from a cataract and retinopathy perspective, is that you have a media opacity. You will not get a good FA or a good quality OCT image. It's difficult to do laser, and in many of these patients, if you do just cataract surgery, the patient actually, if you do just retinal treatment, patient perceives no improvement in his vision. And if the patient does not return for laser or for anti-VEGFs in time, this patient is most likely going to progress to a progression from his PDR to a TRD or a vitreous hemorrhage. So a combined surgery needs to be done for these patients. Either you do a phaco IOL and an anti-VEGF, or as I have done for this patient, phaco IOL and a vitrectomy and endo laser. The issues with the combined surgery is that if it's a hard cataract, during the surgery you will have more of corneal edema, and in combined surgeries we do get more
Aparto.
inflammation.
Aparto.
And if you're going to use a single use anti-VEGF, then the cost for the patient is going to go up. So this is a patient that I saw in October in 2015. At presentation, he had this macular traction, and you can see the fibrovascular proliferation in the fundus photograph here in the right eye. In the left eye also, he had this ring-like structure, the fibrovascular proliferation, and the OCT showed the thin ERM and the spongy. So the right eye underwent phaco along with the vitrectomy and endo laser. The vision did not improve much as he had these large cystoid spaces, but you can see that there is no traction. 1 month later, a few 2 weeks later, the edema or the cyst, they have coalesced, but it's less than before. But the other eye, I started doing a panretinal photocoagulation for this patient, and this eye also had these large cystoid spaces after three settings of panretinal photocoagulation. And at this stage, I gave him an anti-VEGF. You can see some amount of the cystic space has come down, but the thin ERM still persists. This is the left eye of the patient. Then the patient was lost to follow-up as he did not perceive a good visual gain, but then came back. And if you remember the photograph I showed you of this patient, the right eye, the cystic cavity here has come down. The left eye also seems to have settled down a bit. You can see the laser marks here, and the ERM is still there. The vision, however, from counting finger went up to 660 in both the eyes. Add-on PRP was done for the left eye, as I felt that he needs to undergo vitrectomy also in this eye. And the right eye, I didn't do anything. The vision stayed as 660, but he had these large cystic spaces still persisting. And the left eye, you can see that the media has started to become hazy because of the cataract now progressing. Again, the patient was lost to follow up, but when he came back, the vision had improved to 624 in the right eye. You can see the clear media because the cataract has been removed, but the left eye, the cataract is progressing, and the poor quality of the image is due to the cataract. So I think as Dr. Rocha also mentioned that, and we have seen in the past also, these patients, if they don't come back, at least my patient did not progress as far as the retinopathy is concerned. He is more or less stable because the PRP was done at the probable opportune time. So we should not delay in doing the PRP. So this is my case, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Shalab. Again, good documentation. The discussion for these are Dr. Padmija and Dr. Pramod. So Padmija, would you like to initiate some discussion based on whatever Shalab has presented? Yeah, Padmija, you can unmute.
One factor I felt in the case presentation was the vision, and actually the extent of macular edema was not actually correlating. So whether was it the cataract grade was significant enough to start with was something I was thinking about that. And second factor is definitely in terms of progression of the visual recovery after the cataract surgery in this edema. I think it is, we need to see what is the best corrected refraction and as well as what is the near vision quality also, how it has improved significantly. Because I didn't see any biomark, any OCT biomarkers that can be explained, which can responsible for poor vision in this. The ellipsoid zone, the photoreceptor, everything layer was intact. And the traction was also not very obvious.
So I think Shaila must have presented BCVA only. And the degree of OCT and vision may not always correlate. That also is there. But I think right eye has continued to improve from finger counting 660, 624. That has improved. But left eye has gone down, I think, primarily because of the global ERM and, you know, sticky ERM there. That may have been the reason.
Yes, and the last, the cataract also.
Yeah, plus cataract also. That three factors are contributing. Yes, Pramod?
Because that one thing is typically when you are dealing with a tractional maculopathy, I think surgery should be the option. What he has indicated, he has very well shown. Yes, it takes long time to recover, definitely, but probably only anti-VEGF or trying laser may not work. When there is obvious traction, what he has shown, and I think he had opted well, I think surgery was the option, combining with, of course, cataract surgery, cataract was dense enough. Coming to the other eye, injecting anti-VEGF, I would have been a little bit hesitant, particularly the photography shows having a ring-like thing and a lot of that fat proliferation on the retina surrounding the macular area. You are lucky, but I would say would have been, there's always a risk of getting contraction and whole thing getting lifted up. You are lucky enough now. I think now significant cataract is there, but still looking at the fundus picture, what you can see now, and looking at a cataract, counting finger vision does not correlate again now at this stage as well. Because a view is reasonably good enough, and going down from 660 to counting finger, there is something more additional ischemia and derangement of, I think, retinal nerve. Because you look at the OCT, probably you can't make out like a retinal structure well in the last OCT.
Yeah.
Yes, you can.
You see, Shalab, the right eye, I think you were very aggressive in managing and you got good result. You see, you straight away went for pre-op, anti-VEGF, did vitrectomy.
No pre-op, sir. No pre-op anti-VEGF.
Okay. You don't believe in giving pre-op anti-VEGF? Or?
So not for this case.
Not for this case.
Because you already have this traction.
Traction, yes.
You know that the anti-VEGF will not work in this case.
Yeah. But left eye, what is your plan now? You want to...
The patient was very hesitant to undergo any surgery because for him, the vision in the right eye took a very long time to get better. And he was not very happy with whatever was going on in his left eye also. He said
so
that.
What is the plan ultimately? Whether he agrees or not, that's it. What is the game plan?
Any associated optic nerve pathology also is there, because sometimes the disc may not give us any clue. But I have seen some of the cases of these DMEs, and ultimately, if the visual acuity of good enough, you can do fields. Otherwise, even neuroimaging sometimes can give a clue, because CFCF and the presented case OCT is not correlating completely.
Yeah, don't forget optic nerve in diabetics, because if the vision, like Pramod also saying, the OCT picture as well as the fundus picture, finger counting vision, maybe if you are 660 or then okay, but finger counting is slightly difficult.
So because as Dr. Pramod mentioned about the anti-VEGF with that ring-like structure, yes, that is why I did PRP first. and then I gave anti-VEGF. So I think straight away giving anti-VEGF would have resulted in a TRD, bad TRD, as Dr. Pramod mentioned.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
From the cataract surgeon point of view, I will go back to why this meeting for the webinar for them. My only advice is this sudden itch to do a cataract surgery and then send the patient to the retinal surgeon should not happen in these cases. If any of these eyes had a cataract surgery only initially, and telling the patient to isko pehle kar dete hai, then we'll send you to the retinal surgeon after that, will horribly worsen the case. So my request to all cataract surgeons, do not touch the cataract in these patients. You will make absolute mess of the whole situation. I know I'm being a little bit rude.
You're making them our enemy.
I know. I said I'm making them a little bit rude. But sir, it does have all of us see patients.
Agree. Amit has already started shouting. So what I am saying is, you see, except for the first patient presented by Dr. Arvind Gupta, rest all the patients, moderate NPDR or PDR, have to first have a clearance or whatever by the retina colleague. Unless, you know, nowadays young people are, you know, can do both retina as well as cataract. But Dr. Rosha, what would have been your management about this patient? Anything different from what Shalab did?
No, I agree pretty much with everything I have done. I agree that if you can have a view to laser and treat the posterior pole first to do cataract is very good, because if not, you can have iris neovascularization very easy. And many patients do cataract, get better, and just we lost follow-up. And when you come back, you have a glaucoma, neovascularization and glaucoma. And the vitrectomy for traction, that's evident. And I do laser first and after that injection, because the contraction can make detachment. I agree almost everything you have done with this case. And the second case, I think now we need the cataract surgery, because it's hard to see the back of the eye to treat.
So Giri, now the approach should be what? Whether patient agrees, it's a different, what oh, should I be the approach for the left eye? Left eye combined surgery?
As far as the left eye is concerned, I think visual prognosis is very poor. That's what I feel, because as far as combined surgery is concerned, his OCT does not show any traction of the macula. It's more of a macular edema, and probably there is significant macular ischemia, or as Padmaja said, whether there is optic nerve, this thing. So visual prognosis in the left eye, after explaining the visual prognosis, probably if the cataract is quite significant, or if there is a significant posterior subcortical cataract, that's something which we see in diabetics. Probably I may advise first a cataract surgery, reassess, and then do a vitreous surgery. I may not probably go and do a combined thing together, but do a cataract, reassess, and then if necessary, go ahead and do it.
Yeah, I would tend to agree with this approach, because since the vision is not commensurate with all our findings, best is to let cataract surgery be done first.
Yeah.
After a couple of days, weeks, reassess the entire situation, maybe do an opta or an angiography to assess the ischemia, as Padmaja was saying, and as Giri also. So, and then counsel again, because then we can talk in raw language that the blood supply is deficient. If the blood supply is deficient, the tissue is dead, and hence the recovery may not be as per patient's expectation. So any other comment? Yes, Partha, long time.
Yes, sir. So, you know, it is the retina surgeons day to day, and we cataract surgeons have to sit back and just think that, oh my God, what have we been doing with all these diabetic retinopathy patients? So, but again, from the cataract surgery point of view, I think one or two very important take-home messages are there, and so many diabetic patients need to be operated. So the SDOCT, and which has been proved beyond doubt in the Cochrane review in 2015 and all. So it is a must for the evaluation of a diabetic retinopathy patient post-operatively and pre-operatively.
Pre-op more important. Pre-op actually more important, so as to counsel.
Yes.
Post-operatively, definitely you will do, because the patient vision will not improve.
Other things, Shalab's case, in which there was an element of the membrane, the ERM was there. If the ERM was not there, and if it was just diabetic macular edema, center involving diabetic macular edema. Would it be prudent to treat with anti-VEGF, have a flattened retina, have a flattened macula, and then go on to a cataract surgery with this in mind that possibly the anti-VEGF treatment might go on and might be required?
So, with this kind of membrane, most likely the anti-VEGF alone will not work.
Okay. Without the membrane, Shalab. I mean, we are talking about the scenario where the membrane is not there. And
combine your cataract with an anti-VEGF. That will be better.
Right.
And what is the anti-VEGF of choice, Shalab, for you? Suppose there is no membrane, no traction, but PDR with macular edema you are doing. And what anti-VEGF you tend to use in such situation? Avastin or Razumab or
I prefer not to combine a cataract surgery with a multi-dose vial like Avastin, because then you can have endophthalmitis and you will not know what has caused it. So it's better to use a single dose, either the ranibizumab, either the biosimilar one or the Accentrix.
So this brings me to one question. May I ask all panelists present here, except Dr. Rosha, is the role of biosimilars, because all of us use injections in diabetic, you know, even the second case which was presented by Dr. Gopi. The choice, does it necessarily remain Eylea or Lucentis, or biosimilars in your judgment have equal kind of efficacy and safety? How often do you use biosimilars? Maybe we'll start from Kim and Giri and Bhinde. Is your practice of biosimilars same as the originator? Or? Yes, Giri?
So, yeah, I think the use of biosimilars is definitely increasing. Yeah. It's increasing. I mean, it's much more than what we were using about a year ago.
So today, can Kim with confidence, can you use all these biosimilars which are available? Because we have... in India, you see a lot of companies are coming up. Even I've heard a lot of...
Yesterday we had a very interesting session on biosimilar, Lalit. It was quite a good session. And a lot of data was presented from India across major eye hospitals where they have analyzed quite a few hundred cases. And they have shown that of late, there are no issues with biosimilars. So I think the use of biosimilars is increasing. Yeah.
Yes. Kim. Especially Kim. Because of the economic point of view, very often it's not you who are deciding; it's the patient. You're giving the choice to the patient, and of course, you tell them what is your preferred choice. But then, the choice is obviously determined by his economic status, and more so that now that the biosimilar, especially Razumab, has been priced very close to Bevacizumab, I think that is being taken up very frequently than any other drug.
At our place, Center for Sight, we, a couple of years back, we had, 5%. Now, the usage of biosimilars has jumped from 5% to nearly 40-50% of all patients who are advised anti-VEGF. So, that slowly, content level is increasing. Saurabh, Pramod, any comments?
I'm quite comfortable, actually. We are routinely using, but what Dr. Keem said, like we give choice to patient, including even Avastin also. I give totally choice to a patient. He chooses, we tell them that these are three or four options are there. And whatever you would like to, you choose it. But we are very comfortable with biosimilars now. No issue at all. It's like any other original molecule.
Okay, I think we'll move on to the fourth case scenario. After having covered NPDR, two patients, and PDR by Dr. Shalab, we move on to further complication of PDR, that is vitreous hemorrhage. You see, a lot of these patients may present with sudden loss of vision. So there's another message then for a DSM surgeon that any diabetic who presents sudden loss of vision, don't hurry for cataract surgery. Evaluate the posterior segment. So we